we have one, only one God. And that's why the most of the things that Jesus was talking to them were related to that. But on the other hand, Jesus needs to use some a way to present the message in a way that people will be understanding and accepting and using. So they used to have the parables, right, to express the message. And what is that? They use some connection with some elements from the earthly life in the way that people can understand better, and try to do some comparison. You can imagine for us today to talk about something for the King of Heaven. It's not so easy because you have a lot of different point of views, you can have a lot of different perceptions. So even today to talk about what will be the future life, it's not something that is very easy for everyone. You can imagine 2,000 years ago, for Jesus talk about the kingdom of heaven. That is something that nobody has aimed. So it was necessary to use some earthly elements to do connections to that. So when they use a lot, they use something that was very familiar to them, the comparisons, the wedding feast. That's a moment where everybody is very happy, they are celebrating, they are happy to get together. And also it's something that is to celebrate, right? Everybody is trying to do the best for the feast to also be the best. And everybody is trying to do ourselves in the best, in the better way. So, and they used to do all the things because they were talking about for very different holidays. We're talking from spirits for us, because for sure there's, I think, it's something that you can have no doubt of that, about that, but we were there, right? We were also releasing all the things. So at that time, if you are all, you're still studying and you are also paying, taking some time to understand all the things, you can imagine our capacity to understand things 2,000 years ago. So in the first parable, they are talking about the wedding feast, and he's explaining to us how you can enter in the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of heaven. So in this parable, the first to have an idea, they are talking about the king that was celebrating the wedding for his son, and he prepared all the feast. He prepared all the party and so on. And they sent the servants to invite people to attend the weddings, right? But after that, he realized that he invited a lot of people and the impetus, they refused to come. They have other ideas, they are seeking something different and was not prepared to attend the wedding. So he sent other servants and asked them to explain that all the wedding was ready, they prepared a lot of things, all the food was already prepared. They were expecting a very good celebration for all. And with that, most of them was not in a thing at all because they were worried about the business, they were worried about the life, right? And they reject and he didn't accept. So the king was very disappointed. And then he asked again to the servants to send, to go another time, go to the streets, and try to invite not only the people that he mentioned, but at the time, invite everybody. Everybody that was in the street should be invited, no matter what. And so, in the end, he invited everybody, and we have a lot of people there, good and bad. And from a moment, the king saw a man that was not wearing the proper attire. So, it's a wedding, fine. Right? And so he asked, why you are not wearing the proper tie? You're not able to be here that way. The man didn't answer anything. And the king asked to the servant to squat there and leave the party. So we have all the message in the gospel. We can read word by word. And today we'll be doing an analysis of all. When you are considering parable, it's a metaphor, and how we can connect it with our lives. So in the end, the idea is to see, maybe call it the few choices. So if you are trying to understand and do an interpretation of that, the king said, the wedding feast has been fully prepared, but those who had been invited were not worth of it. So go to the crossroads and call the wedding feast all whom you meet. He said, run them into the streets and gather all those whom they met, both good and bad. In the wedding hall was filled with people who sat at the table. So that's the situation. And you are trying to understand, and I think it's very important every time that you are meeting anything, and especially when you are in the gospel, right? Try to analyze every message, because we have a lot of messages that are connected with every paragraph, right? So talk about the wedding feast. Why did Jesus talk about wedding feast? Jesus compared the kingdom of heaven to a feast. In this case, everybody, everything is joy and happiness. And this whole salvation, the first images that they sent were invited for the feast with the compares, right? The first was the people from the Hebrews, right? Because at the time they were, as a nation in the beginning, were the only people, the only civilization that already accept God as our only one God, not many gods, only one God. But they refused, right? So other servants were sent to emphasize the need to go to the feast. And in the comparison, you also can see the second, the other servant that were sent, you can do an analysis with the prophets, because they were servants that was sent by God to explain to us, talking about the law, talk about God, and talk about how to achieve the kingdom of heaven. But at the time, also very little listened to them. Even for the prophets, very little listened to them. So, the entities who made the excuse symbolize persons absorbed with heavenly matters. And if you do, it's not all the Hebrews for sure, but especially if you look the Pharisees and the Sadducees, they were leading the religion, but they also very connected with the power and also connected with the earthly things from these people. They were respecting a Messiah, they were respecting the Jesus. The one that will be coming will be freedom them from the Romans. So they are talking about another kind of freedom. When Jesus comes, and they, not everybody for sure, but most of them rejected and did not accept the message from Jesus. So, and that's the message that is not invited. It's not enough to be invited. It's not enough to be invited, right? We need to have. We need to be with the appropriate attire. That means purity of heart, and most important, follow the law. And all the time that you are discussing what is the law, how you can have the law, and you are seeing what you are listing the spirit is without charity, there is no salvation. So that's the best way how you are putting the law in practice. So what this parable is teaching? Right? We can see, have we been called? Right? It's not for anyone listen and I answer right now. But it's something that every time that you are reading something, it's something for us to internalize. Have we been called? Have we been chosen? Right? The most important, how do we get chosen? What is necessary for us to do in our reflections to be part and to enter in the kingdom of heaven? So the second parable is talking about the narrow door, right? And it's another comparison, but it's a very interesting comparison, right? Because I think in that case it should be easier for most of us to understand. They are telling us the door to perdition is wide because evil passions are many. And the pathway to evil is frequent by most. And he also mentioned the door to salvation is narrow because those who want to go through it must make a great effort to control themselves in order to overcome their evil tendencies. And few resign themselves to do it. It's the man complement to the maxim. Many are called, but few are chosen. So we have a door here just to symbolize the parable. But I think let's go for a more deep analysis. If you can see here, enter to the narrow door, for the door to perdition is wide, and the path leading to it is broad, and there are many who enter through it. Right? What is telling us? We always have to do choices. We have options. We have been taking options for many, many times in our lives, right? And how small is the door to life? How narrow is the path to lead us to it? And how few there are who find it, right? So, what you are studying today, most of these are related to our sentiments, our feelings, right? We can express any feeling to the others, and others can see us in the way you are presented to them. But most important thing is something that you need to cultivate internally. It's not how the people see us, most important how God is seeing us, how we are following the rules or not, or following the laws or not. So most of things. We are to have our vices because we have acquired a lot in this past of evolution, right? It's not a surprise for anybody. We are in a world of trial and expiation. So the vices are still part of us. So all the things that you have been facing, hatred, divide, revenge, pride, intolerance, power, resentment, all the things that are still taking a lot of time on us. But in the other hand, we are also acquiring some new future because you are evolving. There is no doubt of that. If you look, things that you are doing today, things that you would be doing 100, 200 years ago, no doubt that you are acquiring some future. So, in most sense, we are more able to love, to have some patience, tolerance, humility, compassion, benevolence, and integrity. But not in the all sense. We can have some of them in some specific moments with some people, but not with their mind and not in all conditions. So that's why, if you look and if you can measure, we can see that we still have an imbalance. Most of the things are. I can say that feelings is taking more part of us than it would be. And that's exactly all the message that we were talking about, right? Because we know what the spirit is telling to us. You are spirits. No doubt about that, at least for us, at least for me. So we are living this moment that we can have an idea from. No matter the age we have right now, we can have our memories since the beginning of our birth, and we still be living together with our families, friends, and the things that you are doing until we pass away and return to the spirit of life. Most of us, we can have memories from that, but as a spirit, we know we can feel all the things that you have done in the past. It's not necessary to remember the life. It's not necessary to remember what you did or who you were. But you can see the way we interact with other people, the way we express our feelings, all the things that's necessary for us to do. So, for all these spirits, no matter if it's incarnated and have a very spirit and a physical body, or you are disincarnated, that we are using the very spirit, we are all evolving. And this is also part of our time, because our proper time is also related for the way the spirits are seeing us. So, no matter what, no matter what you are saying or expressing, our very spirit will reflect exactly what you are. So other spirits can see us as we are, really, not only what you are talking, not wording what you are saying. So the improvement of the spirits is the result of their own efforts, right? That's not possible to do just one time. It's not for a single corporeal existence that is possible for us to acquire all moral and intellectual qualities that's necessary to achieve the goal. That means perfection. The perception is achieved by a succession of existences, in each of which takes a few steps forward to the path of progress. Right? The progress you are progressing is step by step, but it's not possible to be stopped, even though it will be necessary more time to recover the time that we may be losing. So, to summarize in terms of the narrow door, what's the parable is teaching for us, right? Consider that Earth is a world of expiation. Evil predominates upon it. That's not a surprise, but the good point is that now we have opportunities to know that, try to do our best to change. And if you consider, if you come back on the point for we are measuring our weight, right? We can use another parable, and you can see, well, how much fat we are carrying. Because if you consider all the vices, something that we don't need anymore, right? We can understand that, well, maybe we need a spiritual diet. What is that? That's exactly what the spiritism block is talking about when you're talking about inner transformation. Our inner transformation, I mean, to increase our virtues and be reducing time by time our vices, is the inner transformation. That's the diet that you should be applying and needing to go. So, other teachings. Pay close attention regarding what you hear, for the same measure will be used on you that you have used to measure others. And you will be given even more. For whom to already has, more will be given. And regarding him who does not have, even what he has will be taken away. So let's highlight something here. This nation already has, right? To him already has, more will be given. But in the other way, he's also talking about taking away. Let's try to understand what his mission is. What is possible to be taken away? For sure, if you are a spirit, all the things that is not belong to spirit, and is not possible to be taken away, all the things that is not belong, something that the spirit has acquired by his own effort. So if you're talking about the knowledge, and also, of course, the moral development of the spirit, is there, right? So we need to do ourselves. We are receiving a lot of information we need to use in a better way, the knowledge, and transform us in a more moral person. And if you do that, what is possible to be taken for us? All the things that you would believe. having should be taken for us is the seed that's not belonging to us, since that you are acquiring, maybe not in a proper way, right? And specific all the sins that you are doing against the law of God. So I think this message is very important because you are living a moment, because you received this message from the Spiritism, right? And they also say, "Much you be asking for whom who has received must." You have received this message from Jesus from thousands of years, right? And as a spirit, you have been living that for also centuries. So much you will be asking for the spirits because they have received much. You know, they received all this information from we are our eternal spirit, the reincarnation, the communication from us to the other spirits, all the explanation about the gospel, because it's something that is very important for us, right? So if you look at and put the spirits on them in that context, the spirits, they receive much. But also to those who have taken advantage of the teaching, much will be given. So it's a great opportunity for us to listen all the things and help ourselves to transform in a good way, in a good path. The spirit has multiplied the number of those who are that are called. We are also servants, right? And you are also inviting ourselves and others to the kingdom of God. Because the faith that the spirit teams provide, it also multiplies the number of those who are chosen. So if you look at this moment that you are living right now, we are living in a trial and inspiration planet. But you know, the planet is also in a process of regeneration, right? So that's exactly the moment for us to try to achieve more. If you are able to do that, much will be given. And also, we are also has possibility to have more people be chosen. Because that's the right moment, the moment from we need to do all transformations because the planet is changing. And no doubt about that, we need to change in the same way. And you'll be changing, you will be recognized as a Christian in the way we act as a children, a Christian. So, and he also mentioned, not all who say to me, "Lord, Lord, will enter in the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who has done the will of my Father who is in heaven." So it's not enough to wear the uniform of the Lord to be a faithful servant. It's not the way you are dressed, it's not the way you are talking, but more in the way you are acting. So it's not enough to say, "I'm a Christian," to follow Christ. Definitely not. Look for the true Christian and you recognize their deeds. And also Kardec mentioned his comment, right? You can see exactly the same words in the news. "A good tree cannot bear bad fruits, nor can a bad tree bear not fruits." It's something, it's a message that is very simple and easy for us to understand. What is not so easy, because all the time that we're talking, we need to talk that's necessary to have a moral perfection. And that's the point that we have been failing for many times, right? Because sometimes you are putting the perfection in other people. Sometimes you are trying to follow some other people, some leaders. That's also important. They can do, they can be doing a lot, right? But in the question 625, of the spirits school, Kardec asked, "What should be the model that you need to be following to achieve the model perfection, the moral perfection?" And the spirit answered, "Look at Jesus." So, if you look at Jesus, no matter if you are Christian or not, and also something that also a person from religion, right? And it's not, they are not Christian. They mentioned that specifically all the speech that Jesus did in the mountain was one of the most completed messages in terms of the moral transformation from the people. God said that, right? And he was not a Christian. But if you look at the message from that he's giving, he gave to us, we have all the necessary things to transform ourselves and to move ahead. So we have the question 6:25. So he already invited us, right? He already invited us, and you should be doing what is possible and necessary for us to follow him. So, doing a summary, to enter in the kingdom of heaven, right? What is necessary to do? So first, go through the narrow door. Choose what is necessary to do. One is wide, the other narrow. One leads to perdition, the other leads to salvation. So it's up to us to do the right choice. But also need to have a proper attire. Means all the things that you'll be acquiring by knowledge. But knowledge is not only say, wow, I have a lot of knowledge. Knowledge alone is not enough, right? We can be have a lot of knowledge and say, Lord, it's not enough. We can pass along all the Jesus message, his teachings, because we have knowledge, but it's not enough. Also, we can cast out some vices, transform ourselves, but to get there, and I think the kingdom of heaven is not something, it's a goal, it's something to be achieved, and all of us will be achieving, right? Because I think that's the most important message that you receive from Jesus, and also we also had the possibility in the Spirit to understand better what Christ was mentioned. It's necessary follow and lead all the teachings, right? It's not necessary all before some of them and all before some of people. No, it's unconditionally all the things. And as Spiritists, because we are Spiritists, right? Let's think ourselves how we can do our inner transformation. We can see our diet to remove all the fat of the vices, because it's something difficult to be having difficult to carry all the things. How soon we leave the body, right? And we can do a transformation day by day. And with that, we also have the possibility to have a better attire to live, right? So we are servants as well. We have this possibility. We receive the invitation. We can prepare ourselves also to the feasts. And so I think it's also important to go and invite everybody to the feast. Everybody, I wish a very good Sunday. I hope that my very difficult English was enough for everybody to receive the message, because I think the message is more important than all the difficulties you can have in the communication. Thank you very much. Dear Father, in this moment, we'd like to thank you for the opportunity. You have invited us for the kingdom. And now we are here doing our effort to reinforce Jesus' message in your soul. we already know to nurse all the things that you need to be followed, all the things that is necessary to transform internally, to achieve. In this moment, we ask your support to still be caring in all the difficulties, in all the moments that sometimes you are feeling that you're not doing what you are asking for us to do. We are not acting as Christians. But also use this opportunity to thank you very much for all the things that also you gave to us, our lives, the opportunity to be incarnated in this moment when you are facing a transition on the planet. I thank for opportunity for the family that we receive, for our parents that help us to be here incarnated. I thank you, God, for all the friends, for all the friendship, for all the opportunities to work, for all the opportunities to put in actions all the things you are. But I also thank you, God, for the difficulties that you also been facing. Because all those difficulties will be transformed. Because now we know that you cannot react the same way you have been reacting in the past. We cannot remove the difficulties, this power, this violence. It's important that you understand that you are still living in a planet that most of us are different. We have different thoughts, we have different feelings. But now we know that all of us are brothers and sisters. We know that all of us are trying to do the best for all of us, also through you, your perfection, your love. So I ask your blessing for all of us, this spirit center, for all the people that is coming to hear, to listen about this talking, about Jesus, about you. Please send for all of the people who is here, incarnated your presence, and you can return to our lives, our homes, our job, in a better way. Try to put your light bright in the people.